Morning, Crossroads. Let's stand together this morning. Excited to see you here this morning, and let me just pray over us as we begin this morning, as we gathered here today. So God, we thank you for this morning, Lord, that you have brought us here as your church. And Lord, as we gather here, as we lift up these songs, God, I just pray that you would speak into our lives, God, that we'd be hearing you and the things that you want to speak to us today. And let these songs honor your name. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Come to worship your mighty God. We have come to lift up a joyful song. We will praise you, King. We will praise you, King of glory. And we will respond to love and mercy you have shown us. We will respond to all the great things you have done. We will praise you, King. We will praise you, King of glory. Here in this moment, here in our lives, and now and forever, be glorified. Holy, holy Lord Almighty, all the earth is praising. Holy, holy God of glory, open up the heavenly gates as we bless your name. With grateful hearts, we enter in the presence of a faithful God, the Father of an endless love. We will praise you, King. We will praise you, King of glory. Here in this moment, here in our lives, and now and forever, be glorified. Holy, holy.
Worthy.
And you are worthy, you are worthy, you are worthy of all our praise. You are holy, you are holy, God of glory, we bless your name. Sing, you are worthy, yes, you are worthy, you are worthy, you are worthy of all our praise. Yes, you are holy, you are holy, God of glory, we bless your name. We're singing, holy, holy, Lord Almighty, all the earth is praising. Holy, holy God of glory, open nations come and stand in awe at the wonder of your name, and the whole earth sing and the oceans roar. Heaven sing your praise, the wonder of your
All right. Good morning and welcome to Crossroads. You know, we just sang, the nations come, they stand in awe. And it is so exciting this morning to know that we are a part of, even right now, across the world, the nations, the people, every tribe, nation, and tongue, the languages that are coming and praising God, even in this day, around the world. We are a part of this global body, this movement of followers of Jesus, lifting up his name. So welcome. We're excited that you joined us this morning to be a part of it. If you're new here, we are really excited that you're here today. You'll notice in your bulletin there's a Connect card. Love to have you fill that out. You can turn it in at the Welcome Center out at the hall. We've got a gift we'd love to give you just to thank you for coming here. Also, if you're a regular attender, great way to communicate with us. You can turn it in the offering as well. Prayer requests, next steps you're looking to take, like getting into a life group or getting involved serving, you can let us know on this card. Also today, if you're new here, after the service, we're going to be doing a meet and greet. It's just a chance for you to come and hang out. Some of us pastors will be there just to talk, get to know you, and we can share a little bit about the church, hear some of your story as well. So we'll be doing that upstairs in the lobby area. So if you head out that way and you head up the stairs, we'll be right up there. So love to have you join us. Love to connect with you and just meet you as well. So you can check that out after the service today. Also today, there's an open house upstairs for Thrive. It's a new ministry we're launching for special needs, kids with special needs. Great chance to check that out today, so we encourage you to look into that as well. Also today, after this service, if you are a fifth grader or the parent of a fifth grade student, today is the sneak peek for Rush. Great chance for fifth grade students to take a look at what Rush is going to be like as they make that transition to our youth group next year. So really encourage you to check that out as well. Couple other things in your bulletin, you'll see some of the details. If you love this experience on Sunday morning of gathering, awesome music, focusing on Jesus, turning our hearts to him and lifting him up in praise. If you like that, in a couple weeks, 2 weeks, there's details. We've got another Ignite worship night that's coming up. Really encourage you guys to check that out. They're always a great time, a powerful time to connect with God. And then I also want to ask you, open up your bulletin right now and you'll take out one of these little cards. You got a couple of these little cards in your bulletin. Next week, we are launching a brand new series, and we're going to have a ton of fun with this. Have you ever thought about some of those things that we say to people, some of those comments that we just make sometimes, you know, like, oh, hey, you know, I know that God, he's just not going to give you more than you can handle, right? We say that a lot, don't we? I've said that, right? Or some of the other ones here, oh, you know, God knows my heart, right? How many times do we say that? Do we ever stop and think about if those things we say are really true? If those words of encouragement we try to give to people, if they're actually true? Well, next week we're launching a series called God Never Said That, and we're going to look at some of these phrases that we use to figure out, do they really line up with the Bible? We're going to have a ton of fun with it. It's a great chance for you just to invite your friends, invite that neighbor that you've been meaning to ask. Great thing you can do, and you can do this right now. Actually, take out your phone, go ahead and fire it up, get out your camera, and what you can do is you can just take a picture of this card. You can get the front, and then you can get the back, and you can post this right now. You could actually do this today, but I want to challenge you even to do it this week. Get a picture of it, post it online, invite your friends, tell them to come, because we're going to have a lot of fun with that, all right? Holy Christmas. Anybody there? All right. All right. Hey, this is the time of our service where we're going to give back to God with way more enthusiasm too, because we love to worship him. And so giving back to God is one of the ways that we worship him too. So let's pray right now. Let's seek him, and I invite the greeters to come forward as well. Let's pray. Father God, Lord, we are so grateful to worship you, to lift you up today, and to give back to you out of what you provided for us. Father, we pray that you would come and that you would take these funds as we present them as an offering to you, a gift to you, the first fruits of what you've provided for us. Lord, we pray that you would use these funds to expand your kingdom here in Sheboygan and to the ends of the earth. And we pray that you would be glorified in all these things. We invite you here to continue to speak and move in this time, to challenge us today, to encourage us, inspire us, Lord. We love you. And we pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
I tasted the world seem more than enough. Its promise is fleeting. Water and wine, I emptied the cup and found myself wanting. There is a well that never runs dry. The water of life, blood of the vine. And all I know is everything I have means nothing. Jesus, if you are my one, everything I need right now. All I need is you right now. Just one thing I ask, and this I will see, if only to know you, to be where you are. Go where you lead, my God, I will follow. The things of this world, I count them as loss. Lay them all down, to take up this cross. It's all I know is everything I have means nothing. I invite you to stand with us and sing this morning. It's all I know.
It's all I know is everything I have means nothing. Jesus, if you're not my one thing, everything I need right now. It's all I'm
Thank you, Lord. Thank you for, again, for your son. And Lord, we spend the rest of our lives, and we will, Lord, we spend eternity worshiping him. And God, just thank you. Thank you for your grace. And Lord, pray now as Pastor Nick preaches, God, let us be attentive. Let us listen. Lord, we're not here by mistake. We're here for a purpose. So God, give us listening ears and hearts that desire to listen and obey to what we hear today. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right. Good morning. Okay. You know, I remember the day like it was yesterday. April 28th, 2011, a church planning conference called Exponential down in Orlando, Florida. This incredible privilege to go and spend 4 days learning about ministry, learning about church planning, learning about being a part of God's kingdom expanding. But here's the thing. I had no idea why I was going. An invite from Pastor Jeff that I foolishly declined the year before in 2010, somehow he came back to me for a second year and invited me to come along. So I thought, you know, there must be a reason, right? I mean, do you think he knew why he asked me? In fact, I can tell you that it was only through God's prompting and grace when Pastor Jeff said to me, you know, God has asked me to build into you and I have no idea for what, but I know that it's got to do something with the expansion and growth of God's kingdom. And then I was met with a very stern, so do you want to go or not? Really glad I said yes, because I'm pretty sure he was about to beat me senseless if I would have said no at that moment. So there I was. Day number 4, a frustrated corporate bank manager having no idea why in the world God would have me spend 1 week of vacation and go hang out with a bunch of people who are in ministry. I was the odd man out. I had no idea why I was there. I remember sitting in multiple breakout sessions, multiple main sessions, 5,000 people. I'm looking around and I'm going, what am I ever going to do with any of this? Me and my family in ministry? We're in debt. I'm inexperienced. Honestly, church, the idea of it became literally just too far away to even think about. And I found myself throughout the process very confused. Then I got upset. And then I was sad. And honestly, I hit that point where I was just angry with God. So I did what you naturally do in that situation. I found a place away from everybody and I thought to myself, you know what? I'm going to let God know just how I feel. Because clearly he would never know unless I tell him, right? So there I sat. Third step on these concrete steps, some part of the building in a back entryway, and I remember the conversation so clearly with God. I said, what is going on here? Why am I here? What do you want from me? I took a week off of work so that I could see all of these other people who are super excited about ministry and what they're doing and what you're doing in their lives, and I just got no idea what you're doing with me. I was frustrated. But then I heard God's voice. Are you done now? Yes, I'm done. His response, oh, I remember the words so clear. You're here because this will be you and your family one day. You mean like church planning? I said. That's exactly what I mean. Me? You want me? You want my family? I mean, do you know me? Do you know my past? Do you know what I've done? Again, really smart questions to ask God, right? I heard the answer so clear. Yes. What just happened? What does all this mean? What does this look like in the future? Church, that was 5 years ago. The journey to this very moment as I stand before you for me and my family has been long. It has been hard. It has been exhausting. But church, it has been the most exciting 5 years, the most joyful 5 years that I can remember in my life. The process at times has reminded me and parts of this journey of God, where God had Moses and the Israelites on. You know, specifically that place that we find ourselves right now in as a church, where we prepare for spiritual battle for souls in Manitowoc. But also, church, as we continue to move forward in faith right here in Sheboygan. You know, one of our core values as a church is that it always has been to be a church that plants churches. Many of you know that this year we get the privilege to celebrate our 10th anniversary as a church at the same time we launch our second Crossroads Community Church location right in Manitowoc. Think about that. 10 years. Wow. So you're thinking, man, it seems like a long time, right? Well, the truth is, we don't take the process of church planting lightly here at Crossroads, and I can tell you, we are so confident we know God is on the start of something big here and what he's going to do in the future, and there will be more churches planted, that I can promise you. So today, church, the message you're going to hear is going to be a little different. We're going to celebrate today of what God is doing in this church plant in Manitowoc, but also what he desires to do right here in Sheboygan. So I'll tell you, church, I hope you're ready, because I had a little coffee this morning, got a whole lot of Jesus, so you better be ready. Church, this isn't about two different locations. It's about one church. It's about his church. It's about the church of Jesus Christ. Amen? Along with this celebration, though, church, we are going to cover a story in Scripture that I really think parallels what we're going through right now. Although the story in Scripture is a far bigger magnitude, I think you're going to see some of the parallels we walk through this. In Exodus chapter 32, Moses, he's been on the mountain with God for 40 days, and the Israelites, who Aaron was left in charge of, they've lost their minds. I mean, they completely turned their backs on God. They made a golden calf that they worship, all because they got impatient waiting for Moses to come back down from the mountain with God. Then right at the end, what we see is that God is ready to literally wipe out the Israelites for their sin. But Moses steps in, he wants to plead with God that he would spare them from the destruction that he was ready to bring. And right at the end of chapter 32, God tells Moses, he said, go and lead the people to the promised land, but when the time is right, I will punish them. Doesn't sound very uplifting right now, does it? Now, I'm not drawing a parallel between this story and us being punished for church planting. Please hear me on the front end on that. What I am doing is I'm trying to help you see what the story is doing in chapter 32 and where we're going to go. So again, no parallel between punishment and church planting, okay? But as we walk through this next chapter, you're going to see this. I really believe that. So today, got your Bibles. Exodus 33 is where we're going to be. They're in your outline for you. They'll be on the screen behind me. Exodus chapter 33. Give you a moment to find it. All right. See, now, as Moses is preparing to lead the people onto the promised land, the big question that he has, the big question that looms for all of these Israelites is, what will happen to us once we leave? How can Israel still experience God's presence once they leave this holy mountain? Remember, they just turned their backs on God. And now they're feeling really uncertain about what's to come ahead of them and what might lie, because God said he was going to punish them. Friends, I think this is very similar right now when you think about the questions that Shannon and I, along with our core team, that we face right now, but it's also the questions facing us right here in Sheboygan. Once we leave Sheboygan, what's going to happen? Will we still experience God's presence as we get on the ground and we start doing battle in Manitowoc? Will we still, who's going to fill the leadership roles right here? The teaching roles, the serving roles, that all being vacated by the people that are coming along. Church, these are really real honest questions that we have to ask, but truth be told, we don't have all the answers. However, what we do know is that we, the church, were called by God to be a part of his mission as he continues to build his church, and we are called to play roles that are going to require each of us here, I mean each of us, to be obedient to that. A role in Manitowoc, many of you are wondering, what can I do? Yep, don't worry, don't sweat. I got something for you a little bit later. You'll find out. But also, what is it going to do right here? What are we going to do right here in Sheboygan as we continue to grow, as we continue to see God's kingdom expanded here, as we step up and we step out in faith? So this morning, we're going to look at three things that we need to focus on as we move forward. Three things. And church, when I say we, I don't mean the people that are going along with Shannon and I and this core team to Manitowoc. Nope. I mean we, the church. How do we, Crossroads Community Church, and 30 minutes here in Sheboygan and 30 minutes away in Manitowoc, keep our focus as we all move forward in faith? Verse 1, Exodus 33. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Leave this place, you and the people you brought up out of Egypt, and go up to the land I promised on oath to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, saying, I will give it to your descendants. I will send an angel before you and drive out the Canaanites, Amorites, Hittites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. Go up to the land flowing with milk and honey. Don't miss this, church. But I will not go with you because you are a stiff-necked people and I might destroy you on the way. When the people heard these distressing words, they began to mourn, and no one put on any ornaments. For the Lord had said to Moses, tell the Israelites, you are a stiff-necked people. If I were to go with you even for a moment, I might destroy you. Now take off your ornaments, and I will decide what to do with you. So the Israelites stripped off their ornaments at Mount Horeb. Whew. Sounds cheerful. God says, I'm not going to go with you because even if I do, I might just wipe you all out. That's about the worst thing that they could have heard at that very moment. God says that he's going to send an angel, though. An angel that's going to drive out all these enemies and that they would come up against on their way to the promised land. And when you think about it, the angel, that might sound great, right? Why not continue to go? But see what Moses says here. What he figures out is he learns that God says he's not going to make this journey with them because of who they are, right? Scripture says a stiff-necked or a stubborn group of people. Because Moses knows the sin that has been committed against God, this is a really big deal. And when they hear this, their reaction is to mourn. Scripture says they were distressed. And now it seems all of a sudden that they're starting to understand the consequences that very well might lie ahead due to the sin in their life. Church, this gives us an area of focus that we see from Scripture that the Israelites lost. But we as a church know that we cannot lose. And that is the first thing we need to focus on as we go forward, and that is his place in our lives. It's his place in our lives. The Israelites, they got absolutely impatient, waiting. They screwed up. They replaced God with a golden calf. They allowed that idol to take the place in their lives that God rightfully deserved. He was the one who brought them out of Egypt. He was the one who had rescued them from slavery, and how quickly they forgot all of this. Now, of course, church, I'm not telling you that you got to be concerned that people on our core team will make golden calves, we're going to lose our minds, we're going to turn away from God. No, church, that is not what I am saying. What I am telling you is that we as a core team, we here as a church need to be aware of just how important it is that God keep his rightful place in our lives, because if we don't, he will not hesitate to remind us of just who he is and who we are. In the book by Jim Putman, Church Planning is a Team Sport, Jim talks about how Jesus said that even the gates of hell would not prevail against his church. Jim goes on to ask the question that with more churches closing each year that are being planted in America, are the gates of hell prevailing against the church? Now, of course, we want to look and we want to say no. But if we're being honest, to many of us, we might wonder, are they prevailing? I mean, this would mean one of two things to consider, Jim says. Jim says, either Jesus was a liar, hear me, not true, or were the churches that are failing and closing, were they ever really Jesus' church in the first place? Did they lose focus on whose church it was along the way? Did God lose his place in the lives of the pastors, of the leadership, of the church body? Church, I think we can all agree that none of us want to hear those words. None of us. We don't want to allow God to lose his place, his rightful place in our lives. Keeping God in his rightful place in our lives, that's the first thing we have to focus on as a church. So the Israelites, they're distressed, right? Now they're in the process of realizing, oh boy, we screwed up. But what Moses does is he steps in now as the leader of his people that God has appointed him to lead, and he says, no, I'm going to intercede now for my people, for these people. Verse 7, now Moses used to take a tent and pitch it outside the camp some distance away, calling it the tent of meeting. Anyone inquiring of the Lord would go to the tent of meeting outside the camp. Whenever Moses went out to the tent, all the people rose and stood at the entrances to their tents, watching Moses until he entered the tent. As Moses went into the tent, the pillar of cloud would come down and stay at the entrance while the Lord spoke with Moses. Whenever the people saw the pillar of cloud standing at the entrance to the tent, they all stood and worshiped each at the entrance to their tent. The Lord would speak to Moses face to face as one speaks to a friend. Then Moses would return to the camp, but his young aide Joshua, son of Nun, did not leave the tent. So this is now where Moses, he goes to meet with God. And when he gets there, what happens, all the Israelites, they stand outside of their tent. And way off in a distance, they see Moses going in. And then they see this pillar of cloud coming down to go meet Moses at the tent. I mean, can you imagine seeing that, the very presence of God? See, sanctuaries, see, these tents, they were way off in the distance from where all the other people were. The reason being is that it was believed that you had to get away and be as far away as possible to really experience the intimacy that you were really desiring to have with God. But now what was going on the inside of this tent was Moses and God speaking. I mean, you see, like, it says Moses speaks to God like face to face, like one speaks to a friend. I mean, think about how we speak to one another, right? How we see each other. There's a physical presence there with us in front of us. The point is, church, is that this was not dreams and visions that God gave to Moses. This was an actual conversation going on. What a beautiful image. Gives us the second thing we need to know, as we to focus on as we go forward, and that is his presence in our lives. It's his presence in our lives. So now, what you have going on in verses 12 and 13 is the actual conversation, right? Moses, he says to the Lord in verse 12, "You have been telling me, lead these people, but you have not let me know whom you will send with me. You have said, I know you by name and have found favor with me. If you are pleased with me, teach me your ways so I may know you and continue to find favor with you. Remember that this nation is your people." Moses is pleading with God to tell him who's going to go on this journey with him. And then, God, if you're pleased, teach me your ways so I can know you in this intimate way that I desire to know you. Help me lead your people the way that you have called me to lead them. You know, support raising started last year in August. We really felt God's presence, his call on our lives and the confirmation of this church plant. Knowing that we were charged with raising 3.5 years to cover all of my personnel costs up front really seemed like kind of a daunting task. Brainstorming the names of 400 people, sending letters, making phone calls, setting up presentations, casting vision, it honestly felt impossible and sometimes unattainable in the beginning. But church, what we saw was God raise all of that support in 4 months. 4 months. Church, we had people who we not only contacted, who we sat down and cast vision with, who were so excited, but we had other people approach us and say, "Hey, I have seen what God is doing at this church right here in Sheboygan. How can we be a part of it? Tell us what we can do." And they came along and they were a part of that. But as we were meeting with people for support, we also knew that we needed people to come along with us, to join our core team of people that would come and sacrificially come along with us for at least an 18-month mission assignment. Because honestly, we could have all the support raised in the world, but if we didn't have the people, this church plant wouldn't happen. And then what? At times, church, we felt like Moses. In fact, I can tell you, I had my own little tent of meeting experience with him during this time. I remember pleading with God, saying, "You know what, God, you called us. I'm so sure of it. I've seen you work through support raising, and this is incredible, but God, where are the people? Who will you send with us?" Because church, at this point, we had 6 people, including Shannon and myself. And if I'm being honest, there were times where we felt a little panicky. What's happening? Did we miss something? Did we make a mistake along the way? But certainly we knew that this wasn't a time that we could rely on our own understanding, but to rely on the very presence of God and remember his place in his life and the promise that he gave us and to draw closer to him during this time. So many of you might recall that we then came to you, the church, and we said, "Would you pray with us? Would you fast with us? Would you help us? And let's seek God together in his direction, his will in building this core team for Manitowoc." So, verse 14, right? Now, Moses receives his answer from God. "The Lord replied, 'My presence will go with you, and I will give you rest.'" What we have here now is the promise from God to Moses. And church, when we know when God promises something, we can count on that, right? See, as Moses received his assurance from God that he was going to go with Moses, Shannon and I, we received the assurance from God that he was in this with us. So as a church, if we sought after God, praying and fasting, he reminded us just how in this he was with us, because it felt like immediately God brought people forward who were interested. They wanted to know more about what it meant to be on this core team. And then God brought to mind people for us. And what that led to then was a very busy time frame in January and early February, where we met with over 40 people to cast vision for what this could look like, for them to truly come along, be a part of this core team, and have a front row seat to watching Jesus Christ build his church. What came out of it was something only God could do, as he built a team of 29 people who will be coming with us for at least 18 months. 6 months spent doing pre-launch activities that we've been doing already, team building, covering things like vision, values, and ministries. Because the truth is, we view this as going to battle together. It includes being in the community through this extensive community outreach plan. Again, don't worry. We've got a place for all of you. You'll hear more about that in just a little bit. Starts in the spring, goes all the way to the launch. And then this team, they stick around for at least 12 months after we launch, helping us get people in, gaining momentum as we start to get local people from Manitowoc involved, transitioning that leadership over, and then eventually the majority of these folks, they're going to come right back here. Church, we've got two families moving to Manitowoc with us. Catch that. I mean, like, literally, they sold their homes, and they are following this call on their lives. One house sold in 2.5 weeks. The other one sold in 7 days. You think God's in this? We got two families making the trip from Oostburg to be a part of this church plant. We have someone who used to go to Crossroads, who lives in Manitowoc, who couldn't make the drive anymore because of her health and everything. And she found out what was happening, and she said, "Nick, I felt like God said, I'm not done with you yet." Think God's in this? We have someone who's on our core team, who was on the core team to launch Sheboygan 10 years ago, now gets the privilege and the experience to take his wife along on the journey. Or another couple who maybe wonders if perhaps continually helping to launch more Crossroads location could be the call on their lives. Man, I could tell you, church, I could go on and on. This team and this incredible ways that each person is sacrificing to come along and do this. But you know, I got to tell you, one of my favorite stories, seeing God build his core team, is the story of Ken and Amanda Thede. I first met Ken last November during circumstances that I truly wish would have been different. See, just before Thanksgiving, Ken's dad passed away. You see, Ken's family had visited Crossroads a few times years ago and really had stopped coming. So when his dad passed away, his mom contacted us to see if we would be able to do the funeral for them. Be able to do the funeral for a guy I never met. So Pastor Adam and I, we had the chance to sit down during the planning phases for this funeral, and that was the first time I met Ken. Our interaction was really limited that day, because I could just tell he was processing and just going through what he was really struggling with at that time. The following week, I had the privilege to officiate the funeral for Ken's dad, and afterwards, his wife, Amanda, and him, they came up. We chatted very briefly, and you know, I just invited them at the end. I said, "You know what, guys, just come check out Crossroads. We'd love to see you guys there." Did you see they were broke? I mean, we've all invited people before, right? Sometimes they show up, sometimes they don't. Well, that Sunday, Pastor Adam comes up to me, and he says, "Hey, did you see who's in the back row on the right side?" Church, I'm telling you, like, ran into service, and there they were, sitting in the back row. Man, I was thrilled to see Ken and Amanda there. That day, Ken filled out a connect card, so naturally I said, "You know, I want to connect with this guy, I want to get," so I tried to call him. We missed each other a little bit, and then the very next Sunday, there they were again. I was like, whoa. And then all of a sudden, I get an email from Ken. He said, "Hey, Nick, this wasn't our first visit there. We used to go to Crossroads about 3 years ago. However, I did want to know if there's anything we can do to help with that new church in Manitowoc. Yours truly, Ken." "Why, yes, Ken and Amanda, I do have something for you. We should chat." And that's exactly what we did. As we sat down and through tears, they told me how they felt like God was calling them to something bigger in their lives and how they wanted to be part of something bigger than themselves. Since coming to Crossroads Community Church, these two have made the choice to trust Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. They are plugged into two different ministries, serving their tails off, and they had decided to join the core team. Think God's in this? Let me tell you, God's going to use this couple for big things. This is just the start. All right, back to Scripture. We're about to get to my favorite part here, okay? Notice here how God says in verse 14, my presence will go with you, that I will give you rest. Moses hears these words. Now, he wants to make sure that this promise is for him and the Israelites. So he says he's going to take this request just a little bit further. So verse 15, then Moses said to him, if your presence does not go with us, do not send us up from here. How will anyone know that you are pleased with me and with your people unless you go with us? What will distinguish me and your people from all the other people on the face of the earth? Man, I love verse 15. Moses is saying, I want you. I want to be with you, God. But if you won't go, if you won't go before us, then I'm not going. Moses doesn't want God's praise. He wants his presence. Our core team, we started meeting February 14th. We had a time to gather. We ate a lot of food, 29 people. That's a lot of food. And we gathered, had some fellowship time. But February 21st, we had our first official, we're going to get down to business and move forward. And this was the very verse that we discussed as a core team. Because church, if we are not seeking God together, asking him to lead the way, keeping his rightful place in our life, asking his presence to go before us, then we better not go. We think for a moment in our own power that we can somehow look back and say, hey, God, got a few problems up here, wondering if you might be available to come up and help us out. Church, if that is our mentality, we will not be successful. Crossroads, the same holds true right here in Sheboygan. We as a church needed to continue to pray that God would continue to lead this church to go before this church, because it's not just about Manitowoc. It's about Crossroads. It's about Jesus' church. Verse 16, Moses, he makes this request to God that, again, it's not just him that God is going with and will lead, but all of the Israelites as well. Moses knew full well, as the leader and shepherd of those people, that they were his responsibility, and he knew the high calling that God had placed on him to lead these people. Verse 16, when he said, how will anyone know that you are pleased with me and with your people unless you go with us? What else will distinguish me and your people from all the other people on the face of the earth? Moses is asking God to distinguish him and the Israelites from every other nation they would come apart, to set them apart from the rest of the earth. As one scholar said, angelic guidance would not have done this. Only the very presence of God could distinguish them. Israel was always called to be different than the rest. And the chief distinctive way for that to happen was through the very presence of God going before them. I mean, think about it, church. Verse 16, that's the question asked over 10 years ago as a group of men and women sat together in a room for Crossroads Sheboygan thinking about, you know what? What is it that's going to make this church unique? How are the people of Sheboygan going to know that God's hand is all over this church plant? Would it be the music? Would it be the preaching? The next generation ministries, developing leaders, life groups, the desire to see future church plants, the fact that anybody who preaches has to wear a plaid shirt, that's important. Truth is, there are a lot of reasons why, but there's none more important than the fact that we as a church have sought the presence and the leadership of God each step of the way, and I think we could all agree God is up to something big here, right? Church, we not only wanted people to see something unique here in Sheboygan back in 2006 and for a lot longer. Church, we want people to see something unique and different up in Manitowoc starting now. Church, it's why we've had a group of men playing basketball out there since last September, meeting other guys, casting vision for what Crossroads is all about. We've had a blast doing it. In fact, a few weeks back, the man who runs the league up there, he had hip surgery. Now, this man is known for being stern, unwavering about protecting the rules that are put in place on the court. He maintains a very assertive posture that may be difficult for people to accept or really receive. So when we heard, we've been chatting with him for about 6 months trying to get to know him, so when we heard he was having hip surgery, we decided as a team that we're going to grab him a card, let him know we're praying for him, put a little gift in it, and just something nice to do. So the following week, we came to play, and there was a guy there in his place who happened to be a friend. He came up to Scott Yeager and he said, hey, I just have to let you know how much it meant to him what you guys did. He doesn't have any family or really anybody close to him. what you guys did got him emotional, and it really touched him. His friend said he had never seen anything like this before. He wanted to be there that night to thank us in person, but he just couldn't from the surgery. But he said, nobody has ever done anything like that for him, so I just wanted to say thank you. Church, we're praying that one day this man walks through the doors of Crossroads in Manitowoc and hears the life-changing message of Jesus Christ. We even had a lady from the senior center up there when Robin Dirksey, one of our core team members, she had heard great things because our church name came up, and she said, oh, you guys have a basketball team up there. And Robin was just trying to get some information. So the lady says, oh, my goodness, I just love you guys. They bring such a fresh perspective, and they just aren't as competitive as the other teams. She said, there's such a light in the league. Apparently, this lady has never been to one of our basketball games as I steal the ball, fast break, slam dunk over the defender. All right, that's not true. Never done that. But when she said competitive, church, what she meant was the way that we carried ourselves in the games compared to other teams that were up there, and that there was something noticeably different, unique about us as a church, as a group of men. Finally, verse 17. And the Lord said to Moses, I will do the very thing you have asked because I am pleased with you and I know you by name. Third thing we need to focus on as we go forward, and that is his promise for our lives. It's his promise for our lives. Here God grants Moses with his request. Now by God's presence going before them, the Israelites, now they're going to be distinct from everybody else. They will be separated from everybody else. People are going to take notice. The nations are going to see this. God's presence with someone was considered the highest blessing somebody could receive from God. As a church, we need to trust the promises that God has given us for our lives, to trust his promises for his love for us, the protection of his children, salvation for those who have trusted in Christ, comfort when we go through trials. And church, he promised that he would finish what he started. So when Jesus said in Matthew 16, 18 that he would build his church, the gates of hell will not prevail against that. We can count on that. Done. It's going to happen. Church, it's not up to us to build Crossroads Community Church here in Sheboygan or in Manitowoc. That promise was already made. Our role is to be obedient to what God has asked of us as his church, as his people, when it comes to building his church. He does it. We go along. You know, you've heard the incredible ways that God has fulfilled, right? The promises of building his church through support raising. 4 months. Marvel in that. 4 months. Building a core team, the most incredible group of folks, in just the right amount of time. Standing together. We seek God for where it is that he would have us partner with, who to host on. Oh, I just lost myself there. Don't do that. Yeah, at just the right time. Right now, we as a church, we have to stand together. We need to seek God where it is that he would have us partner to host on Sunday morning, to have our services at. To date, we've met with a lot of different people, business owners, real estate brokers, and yes, the Manitowoc Public School District, the Carmike Movie Theater, those conversations are ongoing. There's a lot of smaller places available up there for rent. Just unfortunately wouldn't allow us the space that we really need to grow or to host on a Sunday morning. There have been places where we've had a real interest in, but unfortunately just haven't had that interest quite back yet. But we know that we just haven't been led to that right place. But we know that God has that perfect place for us because we're holding on to his promise of building his church. And in order to do that, God knows that we have to have a place to invite people. So right now for us, we hold on to 2 Corinthians 5:7 very close. It says, for we live by faith, not by sight. This verse holds especially true to me and my family right now as we just moved to Manitowoc yesterday. I mean, like literally just moved into our new house yesterday. New house, new school for our kids, new neighbors. The list goes on. Moving our entire family up there without all of the details worked out probably seems to carry some risk to it. But we know that God has called our family to the city. Following God in faith right now provides us with all the comfort that we need. Church, a new location in Manitowoc. It's not about 29 people leaving and the rest of us kind of stay back situation. And hey, we'll pray for you. You pray for us. Maybe we'll update each other here or there along the way. No. The situation, as you've heard from the beginning, one church, two locations, which means together we follow God in faith as we keep Him in the rightful place in our lives as Lord and Creator. That we always make sure we are allowing His presence, asking Him to lead us right here in Sheboygan and 30 minutes away in Manitowoc, and that we are obedient to the leading that He has given us and asked of us in our lives. And it means that we grip on and hold tight to the promises that He has made throughout His Word, that it never fails. We can count on that. Because He said He would build His church. His church. So Crossroads, you are invited. You are invited to join the start of a movement of the kingdom of God growing. And I'm asking you to follow in faith as we, the church, all play our part in watching the life-changing message of the gospel of Jesus Christ change one life at a time. Will you go? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank You for this time. Thank You that we could come and gather and worship Your name together. Father, I pray that as a church that we would keep Your place in our lives right where it needs to be, at the very top. That we would seek Your presence to go before us in everything that we do as a church, as Your church. And that, Father, that we would remember and hold to the promises that You have given us. God, we love You. We thank You for inviting us on this journey with You. We're so thankful for the work that You are continuing to do to advance Your kingdom. Thank You for letting us be a part of it. We love You in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. I promise you guys that you would hear about how you could be involved, and I'm going to let Pastor Jeff tell you all about it.
All right. You got to love amped up church planters. Amen. Amen. And I'm not wearing plaid either today. So I'm going to invite the team members that are going along with Nick and Shannon to be part of the Manitowoc Church. Come on out here right now. And yeah, you can give them a round of applause. All right. Well, this past week at the Exponential Church Planting Conference down in Orlando, we had a chance to be down there with Nick and Shannon and some of their team members. It's the largest church planting conference in the world. And they talked about that the theme of the conference was becoming a level 5 church, being understanding the fact that there are 5 different levels that churches really reside at. Level 1, where you are a declining church. 2, a plateaued church. 3, where you are adding little by little. 4, where you are actually reproducing, and 5, where you're multiplying, where it's a movement, where daughter churches are planting daughter churches, etc. And the reality is this: this is kind of, if these stats don't make you a little bit sad, a little bit disappointed, I don't know what will. 80% of the churches in our country are either plateaued or declining right now. Only 4% of the churches in our nation are actually reproducing or multiplying. Why should that scare you, church? Because last time I checked the book of Acts, the New Testament church sure looked like a church that was reproducing and multiplying, right? That's the picture of the church in America right now. You know, here's some more stats that maybe kind of get you understanding how blessed God how blessed we are at Crossroads, and therefore what God is calling us to as a church. Do you realize, church, that if your attendance as a church is over 400 total people, you are in the top 10% in terms of size of church in America today? If you're over 1,000 people in attendance, you're in the top 2%. We currently have about 800 people coming here on a Sunday morning, and yet it's amazing to me how many times people are like, you know, Pastor Jeff, we're just not ready to plant a church. I mean, are you crazy? What are we doing? We're going to lose all those good leaders. We're going to have all these spots to fill. Yep, we are. And yet, we're at 800 people, and so the point is this, church, you'll never feel ready to plant a church. And probably when you feel super ready, it probably means you're walking in your own strength, your own pride, and it probably means we're in some big trouble. We don't feel ready. In fact, let me scare you a little bit more. Here's a slide. Let's put this up on the screen right now. This is just what these people represent in terms of that we're going to be sending out, okay? So it's no big deal. So don't even worry about it. It's 15 Kids Rock volunteers. It's just one children's ministry director. That's not a big deal. We can replace her, right? Just kidding, Shannon. Two community outreach leaders, life group leader couples, apprentice life group leader couples, some Rush small group leaders, one of our leaders in Rush, setup team members, greeters, six musicians, even a drummer. Let me tell you something. On the eighth day, God created drummers for church plants, okay? Because you can't find them anywhere. You can't. Ask Zach. I mean, Zach, we literally, no lie, paid people to come and drum here when we first launched back in 2006. That is not a lie. Here's a gas card. Please come and drum, okay? So we're losing a drummer. That's like losing gold. Acoustic guitar player. Sorry, rest of the musicians. Keyboard player, bass players, vocalists. Guys, the reality is like you're going, oh, man, are you kidding me? We're losing all these people? Here's something I was challenged with last week, guys. It's amazing how many times I will stand up here, and other pastors will, and we will challenge you to tithe of your finances, your first 10% back to God, principle of first fruits, right? And yet, how often will we refuse to do that when it comes to the best people we have in terms of sending them out? We don't want to tithe of those people. So, you know, you can have these folks, but not these folks, because, boy, they're really good. And right now, some of you are like, oh, wow, we're losing those guys, and we're sending them. We're not losing them. We're sending them out. We're sending them out, okay? And so, you know, here's the reality, guys. Some people go, man, can't we just keep getting bigger, Pastor Jeff? I mean, wouldn't that be just more fun? I mean, you know, that's not the picture of the New Testament church. And the reality is this, the truth is this, guys. We can hide and continue to feed that idol of success, that idol of ego, by just continuing to get bigger and bigger and bigger, right? I mean, we could do that as pastors, and you could do that as leaders and as people that attend this church. You know, our church has grown, and it's not there yet, but our church, wow, imagine one day when it's the biggest church in Sheboygan. Who cares? Who cares if people aren't being reached for Jesus? We believe it's more healthy to send people out than to be able to become this big mega church that God might be able to do here. Maybe he'll still do that. Great. As long as we're sending out people and continuing to release leaders like the Acts Church, like the New Testament Church did, we can live with that. I'd love to see a movement. I see some young people in the crowd right now nodding their heads. I can't wait to see what God's going to do in your life. I'm fired up. I'm getting older and older, and I'm realizing that, man, that's not that funny, Mary. Mary, that's not that funny, all right? We're going to have some church discipline discussions afterward. Goodness. You know, church, the fact is this. Multi-site churches grow faster, they have more lay participation, and they reach more lost people than non-multi-site churches who just want to become this big, monolithic, giant, growing thing that just stays in one location. That's just a fact, okay? And so we believe that God is calling us to branch out. And we believe this is the first of many churches that God's going to plant here through Crossroads. Somebody said this at the conference last week, and I thought this spoke to the church that I get the privilege of being the senior pastor over, okay? Every gift casts a shadow. And what they went on to say was this. They said, when you start a new church and everyone gets excited about that, that can cast a shadow with the rest of the 500-600 people who maybe aren't going to be able to go with this team or be part of that plant. So you have to help them understand how they can be part of that. And so that's what I'm here to do today, right now, okay? I'm going to give you two ways that you can be part of what God is going to do to reach broken, lost people in Manitowoc. Number one, I believe that this team right here, as good as it is, I believe some of you are supposed to join this team. And some of you are like, oh, no. I hope you don't. He didn't know. Yeah, that's what I said. I really do believe. Now, some of you are like, man, we want to fire our senior pastor because he's actually telling more people to leave. That's okay. Because I do believe some of you that God has been speaking to should be part of this team. It's not too late. You can be part of something really, really cool. Secondly, the cards you have in your bulletin today, I want you to take them on. I want you to hold them in your hand, please. Please do that. I know sometimes you're like, oh, I'm just not going to do what he... Just please take it out and just hold it in your hand, okay? On the back here, this team's worked very hard to develop a strategy so that we don't show up one day and go, you know what? We're here, everybody come to Crossroads. That's dumb, okay? They want to be in the community. They want to be the hands and feet of Jesus to people up there. So there are events. There are simple ways for you, the body here in Sheboygan, to get involved. Not only are we going to ask some of you to step up and fill those roles that you saw on the screen. By the way, some of you in these seats today, you are answers to prayer. You just don't know it yet. We need you to fill some of those roles. But here's our challenge to you today. Would you check one box? One box. Students, adults, everybody, of how you can be involved helping over the next 4 or 5 months. One box. For some of you that might be serving more than one Sunday for a year. You know, you're going to serve in Sheboygan and you're going to serve up there once a month. But let me tell you, that's going to be a blast for you because you're going to see the church here continue to grow and you're going to see the church there continue to grow. Secondly, for some of you, there's prayer events. There's community outreach events. One box. At the back, there's a black box. In the hallway, there's black boxes and baskets. I'm asking you to check one box today with your name on it, your address, your phone number. Fill it out, drop it in there, and here's the great thing, great news. You have your calendar on your phone right now, okay? So you don't even have to go home and check it out. Because the reality is this, if you leave today without filling this out, more than likely, you'll never turn it in. So can I ask you to take that step? So that we can say to these guys that they're not on their own, that we're doing this as a church family. Yeah, because by turning in this card, it means that you realize that the church is about sending capacity, not seating capacity. It means that you realize that it's about God's kingdom, it's not about growing our own, amen? And it means that you are understanding that sometimes the kingdom of God and the growth of it requires risk-taking, not just relaxing. Like we all kind of want to do. You know, let me close with this story. You know, I was sitting there Thursday at the end of the conference, and there was a call to commitment, and I just sat there. And I didn't get up, and I just sat there with my head in my hands, and I had tears streaming down my face as God started flashing pictures in my mind back to 2004 when I was sitting outside the Green Lake Conference Center just sobbing with my wife, just going, God, I know you're calling us to plant a church, but she's not on board, and if you don't have her, then I can't move forward. Easily the most broken I've ever seen in my life, most powerful time in our marriage, as God led us and said, you know what, this is what I have for you. I was sitting there Thursday, and God then flashed me into my mind, 2006, sitting at the movie theater in the back theater where there was no kids back there back then because we didn't have enough kids. And I was just sitting in the theater by myself just crying, thinking, who's going to show up? My pastor mentor walked up, and who had come up from South Carolina. And he handed me a card, and it was just one of those moments where you're like, no, I know, God, you've got me here for a reason. And as I was sitting there on Thursday this past week, my mind flashed to 2008 where I was convicted that, man, you know what? I don't want to be a lukewarm pastor who pastors a lukewarm church because I'm content to just relax and just kind of let the church now just be the, you know, just turn inward on itself. And my mind flashed to sitting with this couple, Nick and Shannon Stanislavski, at different times and sharing the gospel message with them. Watching them come to know Jesus. My mind then I turned to my left and I could see up in the balcony of First Baptist Orlando, this massive church that this conference was at, this spot up in the corner where myself and a couple of our pastors sat with Nick in 2011 as he just broke, sobbing, coming clean about what had happened in his past. That was going to keep him stuck until he had come clean about it and dealt with it before God. Flashed forward to 2014, watching God through a team of assessors down in Orlando last year, with these guys saying, you know what, God, we see church planting all over you guys. And then as I was sitting there and I just had tears in my eyes, this phrase that somebody had said at the conference really resonated with me. That sometimes God has this habit of coming up to each one of us, and he taps us on the shoulders and he says, you know what? It's time to begin again. It's time to begin again. And church, I want to tell you, Crossroads, God is tapping us on the shoulder and says, it's time to begin again. It's time to begin again. And so I'm praying that you're going to flood the boxes with how you want to be involved. I'm praying some of you are going to be part of filling those gaps. And I'm praying that some of you are going to end up on this team here. Because God is doing a work, and we are excited. It's going to be the coolest year of our church's history, and I can't wait to watch what God does. Amen? Let's go ahead and stand for closing prayer, okay? All right, Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the chance to see what you are doing. Thank you, Lord, that we know that we are only following as you lead, Lord. This is not about our kingdom, it's about your kingdom. And so, God, I pray for each person in here today, those who really should be on this team for a period of time. Maybe it's 12 months, whatever, and maybe they've resisted, maybe they've been scared, maybe they've been nervous. God, give them the strength to say, you know what, I want to do it. Lord, for those who maybe can't go right now, I pray there's no sense of guilt, no sense of shame, but that they would say, you know, I can play my part from here. I can start filling gaps here. I can start being involved in events up there. God, help us do this as your church. Help us not send out a group of people and wish them well and say good luck, but let's bond together as a church doing what you've called us to do, because there are a lot of lost people who need the hope that we have through your son, Jesus. And it is in his name we pray. Amen. Have a great week, guys.